I have to repeat because I didn't stop the previous lesson in the right point for the recording. So we repeat some words. Now we start to see the problem of the positioning with the geodetic problem of the positioning. And we have different techniques. We have seen that we respect to the traditional techniques. We need just to see from the Earth some satellite or some celestial object, but it's not require the line of sight between point on the Earth. So it's a more general, more global techniques that can cover really all the world. We have seen that we have in the traditional positioning techniques we separate the altimetric problem by the from the planimetric problem, because we have really two different instruments, spirit leveling and teodolite or total station. And we also have two different reference surfaces, the geoid for the altimetry and the ellipsoid for the planimetric coordinate. Okay, so GNS, Global Navigation Satellite System. This is a list of the most used global navigation satellite system. The most important are because it was the first is more is the system that give us more precision and so on, is a GPS from United States that was developed at the end of the 70s. There is a GLONASS. GLONASS is also quite old system, but it's not worked with continuity in the past. Now it's working, but in the past it's related to the political situation in the Russia. They stopped to develop these techniques. In the last year, we have Galileo from the Eurospace Agency. Galileo now is started to have a full working system, but it's just the beginning of history. There is other system, probably I forgot someone, and some system are related to a local system. I mean that the satellite are go around the world, but the geometry of observation is optimized for some part of the Earth, for China, for Japan, and so on. So our global system, but in some part of the Earth, we cannot see so much satellite of this constellation. And we have a lot of system because for the physical application we reach a very high precision. For navigation it's better to have more satellite, because in some situation in the city with very big building and so on, sometimes you cannot see satellite in the sky. So if you have more satellite, more constellation of satellite for positioning, you can obtain a better precision. You can see some some observation for the positioning. The frequency used by the GNS techniques are more or less in the same in the radio frequency. We are going to see this in detail we are going to speak about GPS, but you see that all the techniques use frequencies at band L in the radio frequency. And in the last year, they use GPS use band L2 in radio frequency, but now we are using a more wide spectrum. We are going to see later that satellite result ranging is another technique. Before starting with the GPS, I'm going to introduce the other two geodetic techniques for positioning. Satellite laser ranging, that It's based on satellite LEGOs, one LEGOs, two are the two satellites using for this observation, and with a station quite big. This is the Astronomical Institute in German at Wetzel, where we have a big antenna that send the signal to this satellite covered by mirrors. Hi, hello. You are a student from the diploma program. Okay, you're welcome. And this mirror reflects the signal from the satellite to the antenna. And measuring the round trip time of flight, we can obtain information about the distance between the antenna and the satellite. And we have also lunar laser ranging, putting some mirror on the moon to do the same time of observation. This technique is not used for normal positioning, for navigation, but is give important information the definition of the reference system. Especially for the position of the center of the Earth. The center at the motion and give information to study this quantity. That is important also for the reference system problem definition. VLBI, very long baseline interferometry. This technique shares the astronomical radio antenna with the astronomy community and use not satellite but radio search as quasar. We have two antenna over the world, usually at a very big distance, and we use the interferometry. We can computer measures these distances, the baseline, the distance between the two antenna, because the quasar are very far in the space, so we can see that the signal arrive like a plane wave and reach the two antenna in two different time. Before here and after this. By this measure, we can obtain the measure of the baseline. Also, VLBI is not used for navigation because it's a very huge antenna, of course, but it's very important also for geodynamic application because we have antenna on all the different tectonic plates in the world, and so we have a measure of the variations, the relative movement between the plate, but give us also information on the rotation axis of the Earth. For instance, we have in Italy we have four VLBI antenna. One is close to Bologna, Medicina, one in the south in Sicily, Noto, one in Matera in the south Italy, and one in Cagliari in Sardinia. We have also this type of antenna in the north part of the Europe and in other country. It's not so dense in a network, but we have important antenna close to the Arctic Circle. So this is to say, okay, now we are going to speak about GPS, but we have also other techniques that give us information on the deformation and deformation movement of the Earth. Positioning, okay. Have you seen, we want to know the position of a point. It means that we want to know the coordinates of a point. To define a coordinate, we need to define a reference system. For instance, in a 2D example, very simple, in a planar example, we can fix the origin of our reference system. We have to fix the direction of the x-axis and the direction of the y-axis, passing for the origin and perpendicular each other. So this is just the definition of a reference system. When we have defined, this is a very simple example, when we have defined a reference system, we have to define a coordinate system. Okay, this is our reference, where are the two axes that help us to give for the coordinate. Now we have to fix which system of coordinate we want to use. We can use Cartesian coordinate, XY, or polar coordinate, R and theta, the angle. And we can represent the position of the point P in Cartesian or polar coordinates, but we have this representation can be inverted. We can there is a relationship between the two coordinate system. So what we have to take into account is about the reference system, where we put the reference axis as the origin, and the coordinate system are two different things. We can have the same reference system but different coordinate system, polar or Cartesian, for instance. Or we can have the same coordinate system but different reference system. I can use coordinate Cartesian coordinate, but I can have this reference system or another one rotated in the plane. So the positioning these problems means to determine the coordinate of a point in the space with respect a coordinate reference system, with respect a reference, not coordinate system. Sorry.
We have to define the reference system on the Earth, or these are exist on the Earth.
We are going to see this, that is the reference system is a theoretical definition, and after this theoretical definition is materialized on the Earth. We need some point that we use like a marker, like a reference point on the Earth. We are going to see. This is we need, before we need a general definition of reference system. It's like if I want to measure this room, I can start, okay, I can start, say, I take a rule and start to measure, which is my origin for this measure, which are the axes with respect to my measure, I define this. In geodesy, there are conventional references. That means that all the quantities are well defined by the geodetic community. And this reference system has been materialized on the Earth. We are going.
I'm confused because even in this room, for example, if we choose a reference system like the corner, it's not moving, but on the Earth, every reference point I define, it's moving around.
Yes. And we have to take into account for this movement. We are going to see. Also, this point is moving. Okay, it depends on your problem. When you measure just this room, it's not we are solid, also we are moving together. This point, with respect to the north of Europe, of course, is moving with respect to Stockholm, for instance. It depends on your problem. So, geodetic reference system. The traditional geodesy, we have seen that we have two different type of survey for the planimetry and for the altimetry. And we measure different quantity, angle distance for the planimetry, distances for the planimetry. In 1D survey, we measure differences in differential leveling, differences in the height. And for the planimetry, we can use a local ellipsoid, an ellipsoid that fit our zone, is our country, a sphere or a plane. Do you remember the lesson yesterday? For the altimetry survey, we need a geoid, a surface related to the gravity field. So we have a measure and reference surface. For the GPS, or in general for global navigation satellite system, we have a 3D survey. When we the core of the measure is the measure of the core of the techniques is a measure of the distance between satellite and receiver in the GPS. And our reference surface is a geocentric ellipsoid. So it is a rotational ellipsoid, you remember yesterday, put on the center of the Earth. So this is, we are speaking about different geodetic reference system. And so it's not so easy to convert traditional, no, easy, now it's easy, but in the past was not easy to convert a traditional survey in a new system or use with the new techniques. We have, for instance, GPS observation coordinates that we want to put in a traditional chart map, in traditional map, sorry. And in this case, we have to really compute a transformation and translation of a reference system. These are solved now, but was not an easy task. So, with respect to the reference surface, in the past we have a plane, sphere, local ellipsoid, depend on the approximation, plane up to 10 kilometers, sphere or ellipsoidal half, or local ellipsoid, sorry. Local means that we fit in a point. And geocentric, we put the center of the ellipsoid in the center of the Earth. And also the coordinate. We have a plane, use Cartesian coordinate, sphere, use polar coordinate, local ellipsoid, you use latitude and longitude. For the height, we use orthometric height because we refer the result to the geoid. With the GPS that uses geocentric ellipsoid, the coordinate system used are latitude, longitude, and height, ellipsoidal height. Do you remember? Capital H mean orthometric height. Small h mean ellipsoidal height. And we can also use a Cartesian coordinate system, x, y, z. Of course, z don't mean height, it's just a coordinate. It's not related to the height. We are going to see in a picture. Okay, the important things to connect to your question is we need to define a reference system. That is a theoretical definition of our references, our coordinate system. So where is the origin, where are the axes, and so on. But for practical application, we need a reference frame. It means that we have to materialize our point on the Earth. We need a fiducial point, what we call fiducial point. It means that if I go outside, I can see my reference system because I find some benchmark and say, okay, I know the coordinate of this point in this coordinate reference system. This is a reference frame. These are conventional when all models, numerical constant, algorithm, and so on, are explicitly specified. When I fix this angle for my origin, it's not conventional, it's my reference, personal reference system. And in satellite geodesy, we need two reference systems, the Celestial Reference System, ICRS, and the frame. Put attention, S means the system, the theoretical definition, frame is the materialization of the system. This celestial reference system is a space-fixed inertial system. It's important when you have to describe the position of the satellite, the orbit of the satellite. We do this with respect to an inertial system. And we also have a terrestrial reference system, S, and frame, F, that is a Earth-fixed and is related to the Earth. And this is given to use to give the position of the station on the Earth, the observation station. Okay, the origin of this ITRF depend by is determined by satellite laser ranging, and also the scale of our reference frame is defined using satellite laser ranger and VLBI, and also in I forgot, the rotation axis is given by VLBI especially. Okay, now we are going to see in detail what is a ITRS system. Allora, International Terrestrial Reference System. Okay, this is one of the figures, okay. It's a three-dimensional reference system where we define the position of the geocenter and the position of the axis according to some definition, some measure defined in some year, for instance in 1984. Okay, it's a three-dimensional orthogonal axis. The x-axis is along the equatorial plane, and the y-axis is along the rotational axis. Okay, according to the definition of the Bureau International de l'Heure. And it's a co-rotating system, so this system is rotating with the Earth. It's not rotation conditional for horizontal motion. We are going to see it after what it means is. And the geocentric is the origin of this reference system is in the Earth center of mass. Including ocean and atmosphere. We can have a center of figure of the ellipsoid or center of mass. We do measure of the gravity field of the Earth, so it's related to the center of mass, not the center of the figure of the Earth. Okay. Why we need a reference frame? Because in the example of the room, it was simple to say this is the origin and we start to do measure for this origin. But if your reference system has origin in the center of the Earth, it's not possible to refer all the measure to this point because we cannot start from this point and move from the center of the Earth. So we need some point on the Earth that give us, it's like a materialization, it represents a network of fiducial station with coordinate given in this conventional reference system. So when I do measure, for instance, if I have a benchmark in this room, I can start to do measure by this benchmark. Of this benchmark, I know the coordinate in the system that I need. And from this point, I can do the other observation. So, for instance, it obtains the coordinate of this other corner related to this benchmark. Of course, this coordinate are in my benchmark, in my reference system, according to the benchmark. Okay, we can have different reference frame. It depends on the measures that I'm using to obtain the coordinate. For instance, this is the website. Please look in at this website when there are all the definition of the reference frame. So, given a reference system, I have different network of the benchmark because I improve my network, I remove some stations that are not good and so on. In this ITRF is given by GPS stations, so are stations that are observing continuously. There are VLBI station and SLR station, and also Doris station. That is another technique so that I don't present. Yeah, and we have different reference frame. Now, for instance, in 2016, they produce a new solution, ITRF 2014. That is the frame that we are using now. The geodetic community are preparing a new solution, ITRF 2020, that will be ready in 2021, more or less. So, given a reference frame means that for a set of geodetic side of a station of benchmark, we can give position and velocity because the plate are moving, so we need also to take into account of the movement of the side at a given epoch. And this position and velocity, for this position and velocity, we know the covariance metric. We know the variance of the position of the velocity. This is a dynamic datum. Okay, the velocity are expressed in non-net rotation frame. That means the total angular momentum of all tectonic plate should be zero. So it's a conservative rule to control the fact that we have different the plate are moving. It's the definition we're going to see. So, given this, the coordinate system that we can use are coordinate or Cartesian or ellipsoidal. Ellipsoidal Cartesian, ellipsoidal geographical coordinates. So we can have the coordinate with respect to this axis, respect to this, and respect to this. So that could not be a height because the height is respected to the topography, so not with respect to an axis. That axis is like as the x, or the y axis. So it's just a projection of this point on this axis. So we can have longitude, latitude, and the ellipsoidal height, if this is the ellipsoidal, along the normal to the ellipsoid. Okay. We have seen that what is mean as the non-net rotation, the sum of all the movement of the plate with the giving in average a zero values. So we call the non-net rotation velocity is called absolute velocity. I'm going to show you. So you see all the velocity of all the plate. But for the two physical applications, this was is a very old figure, 2003. Now we have more station, but you can see you see that all the station on the Eurasian plate, for instance, have this more or less the same direction. The same for this plate. This is a more complicated. For the Australian plate and so on. But for the physical application, we are interested to the relative movement between station. This is the absolute velocity given in ITRS, but we want to remove the effect due to the tectonic of the plate. We are more interested in the relative movement, in this deformation zone, to study deformation zone. So we can subtract from our velocity the velocity predicted by a model of plate, of tectonic plate. So, for instance, this is another old figure. This is Friuli, Trieste. And this, you can see that these are OGS permanent station, but it's a very old figure. And you see that all the arrows are in the same direction. But if you subtract the mean movement of the Eurasia plate determined using the station place in the north part of the Europe, you see relative movement between stations. Okay, and the velocity are centimeter over here. I don't remember the time. So yes, centimeter over here are velocity. It is the same for here, for this. This, for instance, is the situation of Italy. Take from a paper. If you have put the absolute velocity, all the errors are in the same direction. When you remove the plate velocity, you see the differences between stations, the different relative velocity between stations. You can see where you are more deformation or more stable zone. Okay. There is this website, UNAFCO, is a very useful website where you can find a lot of information about geodesy and so on. And there is a software that you can use just to understand better this argument, this topic, sorry. This topic, and you can choose different reference model, and you can plot the velocity with respect different plate to see how the vectors, velocity vector, are changing. Okay, and this is another software from UNAFCO when you can plot the velocity and change. You see, in the previous software, you compute, you remove the movement of a plate. If you have some result and you want to remove the tectonic plate model, you can use this software. In this one, especially the state, is valid all over the world. You can plot the velocity with respect to different plate model. Okay, this was an introduction, just to say, before starting to see in detail the GPS technique, we are seeing that a summary for you that you are not here yesterday and the first lesson today. Okay, we started to see what is geodesy in general. Geodesy study the figure of the Earth and the gravity field. Yesterday we have discussed about the gravity field and about gravity satellite mission. That in the last year we had two important mission, GRACE and GOES. And we also discuss about gravity reduction, how to remove, for instance, the topographic effect in terms of gravity by our observation. And in this context, we related to the figure of the Earth, we have seen that we can approximate the Earth using an ellipsoid on a geoid. Ellipsoid is a geometric definition of the reference surface. The geoid is related to the gravity field of the Earth. So the two reference surfaces give us two different types of height. We have ellipsoidal height with respect to the ellipsoid, or orthometric height with respect to the geoid. Because the geoid is the equipotential surface of the gravity field of the Earth. And so for engineering application, it's more important to know the height with respect to the gravity field, so with respect to the geoid. Okay, this morning we have discussed about least square method. It was before this because we need to have a common notation about least square, because we are going to see that in the GPS you use a lot of statistical method to purchase the data and also to analyze GPS time series of the coordinates. So I introduce this method in a general form, very simple, and because it was not a really statistic lesson, just I give you this method, the instruments. Now we start the part of geodesy that studies the positioning, the solve the problem of the positioning. So in this part we have defined the reference system. The reference system, reference frame, are at the base of the GPS. With the GPS we obtain coordinates, so now we know with respect to which reference system. When we speak about GPS time series, we are going to speak about reference frame again, because we are going to see the problem when we change a reference frame, when there is an updating of the reference frame. But at the moment it's just to say, okay, we compute the position of the receiver, GPS receiver, with respect to this system, reference frame. Okay. If you write your email address in this paper, I can send you the link to download the slide in a Google Drive repository. Do you need a pen? Okay. Okay. Now we start to see in in detail the GPS technique. GPS, the full name is NavStar, Navigation System with Time and Ranging, Global Positioning System. Time and Ranging, so time and distance, because GPS is also used to give information on time. For instance, in the seismic network, in the seismometer, there is a GPS to give time. Of course, we know where the instrument is, but we know to exactly the time of the event. So GPS is also used for time. We are going to see why for time. It's a satellite-based radio navigation system, provides 3D position and time information. So it's like four dimension. It's Y, Z, the three coordinates, plus time. Has been developed in 1970s and at the beginning was a military system. It's still a military system, but the beginning was really under the military control. They could decide to modify the signal so only the military can use this system for positioning. Now it's not more this, it's under a military service, but the civil part is completely separate by the military part. They have some specific channels that can use for their aim, but it's not, it's quite separate. So the aim was a real-time positioning with a precision less than 10 meters, with also for a fast-moving vehicle. And this system has to work under any weather condition and all over the world. So they wanted a system that can give your position everywhere and under any condition. The GPS is based on three segments. We have the space segment given by the satellite, the control segment that are stations that control the satellite, and the receiver. Please look at these arrows. The space segment, the control segment can transmit information to each other. But for the user segment, this system is a one-way system. The receiver receives information from the satellite, but no one receiver can send information to the satellite, of course, because if you think that in any mobile phone we have a GPS, is impossible that the satellite receive this amount of information from the Earth. So we are looking at the GPS constellation. Okay.
You said the accuracy is 10 meter.
At least 10 meter for navigation application. We are going to see that the system were developed to have this type of precision, because the first application were to know where we are in a desert during a war, for instance. But we are going to see during the next lesson how to improve this accuracy to have now a positioning with a millimeter precision or less.
Yeah, of course, because the next question is, we can be the reference point, I think, solve this problem. You know? For example, I put my phone here and receive the position from satellite. I know the exact position. And with this position, I can improve the accuracy. For example, I know the position of this mobile phone here, but but the satellite told me the mobile phone is here. I know the 1 meter at least I have it.
Yes.
So with the phone, with this reference point, I can solve this problem. Why we do not this?
It's more complicated. You receive signal from the satellite. You receive it in the mobile phone. Computer is your receiver that computes your position. It's not given by the satellite. You computer is a, in your phone, compute your position. And compute your position with a precision of some meters. In fact, when if you use GPS, for instance, for navigation with a Google Map or something like this, you see that if you have a new road and this new road is not on your map, is not updated to the new road, the system take time to say, okay, well, you are out of the road. You try to stay on the road. And this is because you have a precision of some meter, and okay, the system knows that you are going along a road, a street, so try to constrain you to stay in this road. But this is related to the precision of the system. For navigation, usually some meter of precision is okay, except when you have very difficult situation, mountains with the fog, I don't know, but so you have to be very careful. For navigation, some meter is okay to know where you are. And for geophysical application, of course, it's not sufficient, this type of precision. And we are going to see that for geophysical application, we don't use this type of GPS, the GPS inside this. We separate receiver from antenna, and we use more and more sophisticated antenna, and we process the data in using different software, not the software that we have in mobile. So okay, the precision at least some meter, but we arrive to the millimeter. And during this lesson, I'm going to show you how many things we have to take into account to arrive to a millimeter of precision in the positioning, or less if you consider the velocity of a point.
Sorry, because I've lost yesterday, I wasn't here. The satellite send a ray or a wavefront?
We are going to show now. We start in GPS now. GPS is the first slide on GPS technique. So the satellites have place in almost circular orbit. We have six orbit. So the satellites are distributed in six orbital planes, with an orbital inclination of 55 degrees. And in each orbit, there are at least four satellites. The configuration of this orbital plane are made to guarantee that we can see at least four satellites simultaneously all over in the world. Of course, it depends if you are in a city with a very big building, probably you cannot see all the four satellites. This is the reason we need more constellation of the GNSS. But in a normal place of the Earth, the configuration of the satellite guarantee at least four satellites. We are going to see why we need four satellites. And the period, orbital period, is about 12 hours of sidereal times. That means that in a local time we have 11 hours, and 56 minutes. So there is a delay, the satellite arrived before 4 minutes, after 12 hours. So given satellite number one, this satellite can be seen from me twice a day. The orbit of the the altitude of the satellite is really, really high, 20,000 kilometers at 200, more or less. It's very fast because we are going to see that we compute our position knowing the position of the satellite. And we need a very stable position of the satellite. If the satellite are low in the atmosphere, you remember the GRACE mission, the altitude is about 500 kilometers. It's lower, really lower than the GPS satellite. But we need a very stable orbit. Without drag, atmospheric drag or other effect that can perturb the satellite orbit. So the satellite are really high away. It's a one-way ranging system because the signal are only transmitted to the satellite. At the beginning there was 24 active satellite plus 4 spare. Now we have, I don't check this number, but usually we have at least 30 satellites. So it's bigger. Okay, this is some information about sidereal time. Is our angle of the vernal equinox. Okay. Okay, this is if you want information about sidereal time. I want to finish this description of the system. Each satellite has on board 4 atomic oscillators. At the beginning was cesium and rubidium. Now the new generation satellite is changed the type of atomic oscillator, but they have a 4 o'clock because this is the core of the system. They have to produce an electromagnetic signal, and to do this they use atomic oscillator. Have a redundant number of atomic oscillator to be sure that one of these are working. For instance, with the Galileo mission, they put in orbit 1 satellite and 4 satellites, if I remember. When they was in orbit, they realized that some oscillator didn't work. And unfortunately, at least one was working, so the satellite, the measure can be done. Okay, the satellite has this solar panel need to correct the position of the orbit of the satellite, and also and there are also batteries when the satellite is covered by the Earth and doesn't receive the signal from the sun, so when it's in the shadow cone of the Earth. And it has also a propulsion system to correct its orbit. The control segment, is a segment under the control of the NASA, control the satellite system. On this station there are other atomic oscillator to check the atomic time, the signal in time. This signal computes the satellite predict the position of the satellite and the behavior of the satellite clock and give this information to the satellite. So the satellite has information where it should be in the orbit. This is, we are going to see that this import information because the satellite send us this information where the satellite is, and he receives this information by the ground and can command a small movement to correct the orbit. The user segment are the GPS receiver. And usually, okay, in this case we have antenna and receiver together, but usually we have antenna and receiver as two separate devices, and it's a one-way system, and the receiver, okay, receives the signal from the satellite and can compute its position using the information, the signal received by the satellite. We are going to see how we can the receiver can compute its position. Okay, there are different types of receivers, the smartphone. We have simple receiver for cartographic application, for instance, to put data in geographic information system in GIS. So we have an antenna and GPS and a little remote control to put additional information about the point that you are observing. And this is a quite big antenna that was used in continuous GPS stations, observing continuously. Or we are other system, receiver, controller to add information to the data that we are collecting, antenna that can be more or less of this dimension, and we can also have a connection via radio to send information and so on. This is a typical surveying equipment for topographical surveying application. Okay, now we are going to see what is a GPS signal. We have seen that on board of the satellite there are four atomic oscillators that produce an electromagnetic signal with this type of frequency, which is the fundamental frequency of 10.23 MHz. This is a radio wave in L band, and they produce, starting from this fundamental frequency, there are produced two other signals called carry, L1, L2, and there are produced also code, binary code, CA and P, and a message. So these are all the signals that derive by this fundamental frequency. Now we are going to describe this other signal. So the
L1, E, L, are they just letters? E is just a letter.
E?
L1?
L1? E. Ah, sorry, and.
Okay.
Sorry, and. This E, where is E? Sorry, it's an Italian word, mean okay. And.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
Sorry, Benny.
So the same thing for the second one.
Exactly. It's an Italian lesson. It's
yes.
Sorry.
And radio waves in L band means? L band?
L band is in the electromagnetic spectrum. You have the radio and it's divided in different spectrum. And we have L band is the band with a wavelength of about 20 centimeters of wavelength. Usually I put the figure, probably in the inside I put the figure of the spectrum. The three carry are modulated by code. So this is original carry, is an electromagnetic wave, so we can represent like a sinusoidal periodic function. The code are pseudo random noise code. It means that our binary code minus or plus one or one and zero is a binary code, and are very long sequences. So this code is repeated really after a very long period, also weeks. So it's called pseudo-random because it's like a random, but it's not random, and it's important that this code is not random because it's a core of our measure. This carry phase is modulated by, because this is a periodic function equal time by time. We have a period, and after this period, this signal repeats itself. And this signal is modulated by this signal, and we have the modulated carry. Okay, this is probably is not correct, this is more or less. It's just a plot. Okay, so the carry, we have so the carry are generating multiplying the fundamental frequency F0 for some coefficient. So the carry L1 is obtained multiply the fundamental equation for 154. The frequency F2 is obtained multiply for 120. And we have two different wavelengths. So L1 have a wavelength of 19 centimeter, and L2 have a wavelength of 24 centimeter. And now I introduce carry 5. Some years ago, this row wasn't. It's a modernization of the system, especially after the development of the Galileo. Galileo is similar, but has a three frequency, and we are going to see why we introduce a third frequency in the system. We are going to see in the next lesson. And also the GPS was modernized, was improved, and the new satellite will have three carry. L1, L2, L5. And it's very complicated to follow all this type of modernization. And if you want have information, there is this website, gps.gov, when it's explained all this type of modernization. But we'll start later. Okay. The number of carry is related to a sort of error due to the ionosphere. The ionosphere is a layer of the atmosphere where we have a lot of ion and electron, and there is an interaction with the GPS signal. The ionosphere is a dispersive medium for the GPS signal. It means that the velocity of this GPS signal wave change with respect to its frequency. So if you use more than one frequency, we can control and remove this type of error. We are going to see in the lesson on the GPS error on Monday. So the code, we have CAP, and I added also the M code, that it was a new code for military service. This code had the C pseudo random noise binary code, the sequence used to modulate the carry. It's a very long period, but it's well defined. C code mean clear acquisition, is generated with a G, okay, this is a very electronic information. And this code module just the carry L1, and it is a civil code because okay, this code is also valid. The P code have a different frequency, a period of 38 weeks, so it repeats itself after a very long time. Each satellite has a portion of the code lasting 7 days, and it's important to recognize the satellite, the signal which signal arrive from a given satellite. So the receiver obtains all this electromagnetic wave, collect all this electromagnetic wave. Analyzing the code, it can say, okay, this comes from satellite 1, satellite 2, and so on. And this code module, so both the carry, yes. I'm not sure that this is really correct now. In the past, the government, the USA government, can decide to modify this P code. Modify so when the user that use GPS for navigation has problem to localize itself. Now, under the government of the President Clinton, they remove this opportunity, and now they introduce a specific code, a military code, that is can use just with a specific instrument that have the military. Okay, I know that all the students are really curious about this part of the military service, but to be honest, also when the P code could be modified for geophysical application, we don't have problem, because we are going to see that we don't use the code for positioning. We are going to see. So it's not really a problem for us. And now the GPS is all over the world, and all the people for United States has a GPS in all the applications. So I think that for this reason I decide to use a specific code for the application that I don't really know. So, okay, it's been made by NASA, but we can use without any problem, especially for geophysics. For geophysical application, we don't have this type of problem, because we are going to see that we use just a carry without a modulation.
So, but I don't understand exactly what's the advantage of the M code.
I don't know exactly. I think that because you can, I don't know exactly. Sorry. I try to understand. Please look at this website, because I try to understand exactly all this modernization. But in the past, were clear. You have you have a better positioning using the P code, mm-hmm. instead of the C code. So if they modify the P code, was really a problem in real-time positioning for navigation. So this was clear. But now I don't know what they can do with the M code. I think that it's really to be sure that they can switch off all the system, and they can use the GPS. I think that, but I'm not really sure. Please, if you want, if you are interested, I'm not interested in the military.
No, just about curiosity, because you said that with the P code we can get millimeter accuracy. Yeah. So that's
millimeter, not
centimeter.
Meter accuracy.
Centimeter accuracy.
Yes.
I think it's.
They say that it's independent.
The information carried. Send it by the satellite. We don't have the period of the code in the satellite. It seems that the military code just sends the information without this difference in the satellite. so you can reach your position.
Maybe a good chat. That doesn't.
Okay, if you can see the website, I try to understand, but to be honest, I prefer statistic paper than this electronic things. Okay, another type of code is a message. Message is an important thing. Because in the message recorded the position of the satellite. We have, I told you that the control segment send the position of the predicted position of the satellite to the satellite. The satellite in the decode, sends this information to the user. So the user have to compute its position, but they measure the distance between receiver and satellite and know the position of the satellite because it's in the signal, in this message. And also there are also information about the health of the satellite, if you can use this satellite because it's available or not. And also information about satellite clock and so on. Okay. This is because it's a real-time positioning. It's a system that you can determine your position in real time. So the total signal sent by the satellite is given. We have to add also L5. I know, but at the moment we are discussing a classical way. We have L1 that are the carry. This is the carry, the sinusoidal wave, are modulated by the P code and the D code. C code, and by the message D. L2 is modulated by the P code and the message. Okay. These codes are just a binary code. So, what we want to know is the coordinates of the receiver, this term, X, Y, Z, in this we have seen reference system, isocentric reference system. And we are going to measure the distance between satellite, between receiver and satellite. And we are going to see how we can measure this distance. And what we know are the coordinates of the satellite. So the simple equation between observation and unknown is this one, is a Euclidean distance between satellite and receiver. Okay. The simple way to see this is that we have a clock on satellite. We have a clock on receiver. The receiver have a clock, but are not of the same quality of the atomic oscillator on board of the satellite. Of course, it depends on the receiver, and we are able to measure the travel time between satellite to receiver. And this travel time, we know the time, we know that is electromagnetic wave, so the velocity is the light velocity, see? So we can convert this measure in distance. We are going to see in detail. So, how we can measure this distance? With using the code or using the phase of the carry. We have two different types of measure. The first one is used for navigation real-time application. For geophysical application, we use phase measure. So, we have seen that we want to measure the travel time. The time that The signal start from the satellite and arrive to the receiver. And we measure this different time interval. Multiply for the velocity of the electromagnetic wave, we have the distance between receiver and satellite. But we have seen the basic, we don't know how to compute the difference of time. So, this time interval is obtained because the satellite signal, because we have a clock on the satellite that produces the signal, and we have a clock on the receiver. When the receiver receives the signal arriving from a satellite, the receiver produces a similar signal, a replica. Because he know all the carry, but he know also the code that are modeling our carry. So when a receiver switch on and a satellite is tracked, it produces a signal like the one that he have received. But this signal will be translated in the time. So we start from the code. The code at the given time. This time, this signal is translated and correlating the signal, we can obtain a measure of time. We have to shift in the time. We are going to see this picture. So, this is the signal of the satellite. This is a signal, the same signal generated by the receiver. These two signals are equal, but just shift in time. So when you move, you correlate the two signals, shift in time one sigma, you obtain the measure of the time between the satellite and the receiver, the travel time of the signal. You understand, and you can do this because your carry are modulated. So if you not modulate your carry, it's a periodic signal, so you can is equal, you cannot correlate. But with this modulation, you can understand in which part of the signal you are, and this part is correlated to the time, because it's product a different time. So we can shift in the replica with the signal received by the satellite. We can have information about the time interval. To be honest, it's more complicated because to be honest, we have to at least 3 o'clock, the satellite, the receiver, and the GPS time under the control of the control segment. So each clock has a different time. We have to synchronize all this time, of course, but it can be done. So, with respect to the GPS time, the correct time, we have also an offset of the receiver clock and an offset due to the satellite clock. But the clock of the satellite, the atomic oscillator of the satellite clock are really good because are high precision atomic oscillation with as an approximation of 1 nanosecond. All the satellite can be considered synchronize each other. To be honest, for geophysical application, we have to take into account also of this, but this information is provided by some organizations that give us a more precise orbit for the satellite and more precise information about the synchronization of the clock. But we can see that we introduce Okay, the error of the synchronization between the satellites is equal to 1 nanosecond. That means an error of about 30 centimeters, just only for the synchronization of the satellite. With the clock of the receiver, the situation is worse because our clock are not of the same quality of the oscillator atomic. So in this case, we have to take into account of the non-synchronization between satellite and receiver. So in the equation that we have seen before, that is called pseudo-range, because it's not the exact range between satellite and receiver, we have to take into account also for this synchronization error, few other errors that we are going to see. So we compute the distance, then in the equation we have information about the satellite position and this and we perform a measure of the time. Okay, this measure of the time gives us the distance plus the synchronization error due to the different quality of the receiver. So, if you look at the previous equation, which are the unknown parameters? Are x, y, z, plus this error, because we don't know exactly which is the synchronization error, because why I can have one error because I'm using a smartphone, but if I use a more sophisticated receiver, I expect that this error is less. So the unknown parameter are four: the coordinate and the synchronization error. So these four should we remember you that to solve in real time this problem, you know, we need to see at least four satellites simultaneously. Because for each satellite, we can write a pseudo-range equation. And to solve the problem with four unknown, we need at least four equation of observation. In fact, the constellation has been designed to respect this condition, as we have seen. Okay, in many receivers, when you are not so interested in a real-time position, you can record this information, this equation, and you can compute your position in post-processing using a software and combine all the observations that you have collected. For instance, if I switch on my receiver now, I get at least four observations. I can see at least four satellites. I collect, now and for 10 minutes, I collect a lot of information on all the satellites, and for this time, I can use a least square adjustment to compute the four unknown, x, y, z, and the synchronization error. Okay. And as we have seen today, if this is the observation equation, the least square will be not linear because the unknown are under the square root. So, okay, this is the last slide for today. So, an empirical rule gives us an idea of the precision of the observation. When you use code CA, that has a wavelength of about 300 meters, you have a standard deviation of about 3 6 months meters. Sorry, I'm sorry. Because there is this rule that says that the precision is 1-2% of the wavelength of the signal. With code P, with a wavelength of 30 meters, the precision is better. This is just a theoretical precision, without taking into account all the other sources of error. It's just a relationship related to the wavelengths. The wavelength in this case is like our meter. You have a signal that repeat itself after taught signal, and this represent our rule that we are reporting. Okay, is okay. In the next lesson on Monday, we are going to see how we can measure this distance between satellite and receiver using phase measurement. That is the measures that we really do for geophysical application, because we are going to see that from a theoretical point of view, we obtain millimeter precision. After, we are going to see that there are a lot of error, that source of error that we have to take into account. For instance, ionosphere, we have already seen that we have the problem of the ionosphere. Okay, but I think that we can see this slide on Monday. Okay, a lot of things also today, sorry. It's a very dense course, but okay, if you, in this day, you have problem, you can contact me by email. I put the slide in Google Drive, and the first lesson in the introduction, there are all my contact. So you can contact me. We can also speak with Skype or something like this, or by email. So you are free to contact me. Okay, you have a homework, do you remember? A least square problem. We are, yeah. I'm sorry.
In that, is it linear? It looks like it's not linear. Why is it not?
It's a linear, I give you a linear problem.
Okay. No, I'm confused.
Don't worry.
A plus B S plus C X squared.
It's a parameter, it's a linear with respect to the observation.
Okay, it's the parameter.
The parameter, yes, it's linear. Okay. So it's you don't have, I think, a problem. Okay, you try. It's just a homework to improve your... You can do by Octave, by Excel, I don't know, Python, or Fortran, what do you want? I don't know if you use any... But it's quite easy, and it's important because we are I want to give you another homework later on the process of a 1 GPS time series. So it's better that you have clarify all the things. Okay. I'm really tired. I confuse my word after I try to speak Italian. So when you realize this, you say, you can stop. Okay, stop.